A packed schedule for President Marcos on the final day of the ASEAN Summit in Indonesia. The Philippine leader meeting with the prime ministers of Cambodia and Vietnam following talks with U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris on maritime security. Let's get the highlights from our very own Katrina Domingo. Kat?
Hi, Carmina. The Philippines and Vietnam are finalizing a five-year rice trading agreement. That's according to Vietnamese Prime Minister Pham Minh Chinh. He said that during his bilateral meeting with Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. with a Vietnamese leader, saying that the two countries will conclude an intergovernment agreement on rice trade so that our rice export, or rather Vietnam's rice export to the Philippines, will ensure food security in the Philippines. He says he looks forward to having a stable framework of cooperation on rice trade for a long period of at least 5 years. He says this way, Vietnam can ensure that it can have adequate exports of rice, while the Philippines can ensure that food security will not be a problem, at least in the next half decade. Carmina, President Ferdinand Marcos, who we all know also heads the Department of Agriculture, earlier imposed a price ceiling on several rice varieties, and he expressed optimism over his Vietnamese counterpart's willingness to import rice to the country, noting that food supply is indeed a main issue in the Philippines. He says while his administration is anxious, he hopes to continue the very fruitful arrangements. Now, Carmina, aside from agricultural cooperation, the Vietnamese leader also thanked the Philippines for expanding its ties with Vietnam in other areas, including maritime security, and also urged the Philippines to continue the exchange of high-level visits. Now, aside from Vietnam, President Marcos also held a bilateral meeting with his counterpart from Cambodia, and we are still waiting for Malacanang to release details of that meeting. Now, Carmina, as you mentioned earlier, the Philippine president also met with U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris last night on the sidelines of the U.S.-ASEAN summit here in Indonesia. And among the things that they have discussed is how the Philippines and the United States can further enhance its maritime cooperation. Details of those discussions still being yet to be released by Malacanang, but what we do guarantee is that the White House has already mentioned that the U.S. is committed to further strengthen its ties and its partnership with the Philippines. Right now, Carmina, if you can see right behind me, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres is set to have a press conference here in Jakarta before the ASEAN concludes its 43rd summit. Carmina.
All right, Kat, still on the precedent, but no longer about the ASEAN summit. Any word from the president's team there about the resignation of Finance Undersecretary Cielo Magno?
Unfortunately, Carmina, we have not yet spoken to the president or any of his secretaries or undersecretaries here. We are still on a wait-and-see mode on whether or not we will be granted an interview later in the day. The president has a very tight schedule right now, and we have yet to hear from Malacanang with regard to those questions. Carmina.
All right. Thanks a lot. Katrina Domingo there, joining us live from Jakarta in Indonesia. Former Senate President Franklin Drilon lauds strong statements from President Marcos during the ASEAN summit on the West Philippine Sea issue. Drilon admits there's little hope ASEAN would take a stand on the matter due to the principle of non-interference and unanimity. But he insists it is important to make China's aggression known in the global stage.
While indeed there is a validity in the criticism that the Asian Forum is a useless talking shop, I fully support the attendance of the president in the ASEAN Forum. Why? Because this provides us, a small nation, with a venue through which we can engage China in the West Philippine Sea. It is extremely difficult to get unanimity on the West Philippine Sea because of the influence of China. That cannot be denied. But we must not give up. We must not give up on bringing to the attention of the world through the ASEAN Forum where we stand.
The former Senate president also flagging the transfer of funds from the office of the vice president to the vice president's office in 2022. See, last year, The office of Vice President Sara Duterte received some 221 million pesos in funds from the office of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Of that amount, confidential funds worth 125 million pesos went to the OVP's new satellite offices. Drilon explains why the move is unconstitutional.
Under the Constitution, no law shall be passed authorizing the transfer of appropriation, because the power to appropriate public funds belongs to Congress and not to anyone else. Now, the Constitution provides an exception, and the exception is the Congress may by law authorize the agencies to augment any item in the government, in the GAA, from the respective offices, from savings, was their augmentation valid under the law. I was there when this budget was being debated upon in 2022. And there was no request for confidential and intelligence budget from the office of the vice president. The power to augment cannot be used to fund non-existing items in the budget.
Drilon now calls on lawmakers to closely scrutinize requests for CIFs in the 2024 budget before things go out of hand.
As we go on over the years, there will be increases in the confidential and intelligence funds budget. So this is something that we should take seriously. Before it goes out of hand. I think it's already going out of hand today, but we should adopt policies to prevent further abuse of this privilege. COA should be invited to those briefings. And maybe we impose the rule in the General Appropriations Act. No further confidential and intelligence funds will be released until the report is submitted on a quarterly basis to the Oversight Committee of Congress. So, it is possible to correct this.
Philippine Finance Undersecretary Cielo Magno has quit her post. The Economist says she will return to teaching at the University of the Philippines, adding it will give her flexibility to advocate for good policies. As Undersecretary, Magno oversaw the DOF's Fiscal Policy and Monitoring Group, which is responsible for formulating tax reform proposals and other fiscal policy recommendations. Before she announced her resignation, Magno posted a cryptic photo showing the chart of the law of supply and demand. Her post garnered comments saying Magno should teach economics to cabinet members as well as to agriculture and trade officials. Magno's resignation will take effect September 16th. Philippine specialty hospitals stand to get less funding next year as the health department faces a budget cut. We have this report.
The Health Department's proposed budget for 2024 is 3% lower compared to its 2023 budget. This was revealed as the House tackled the agency's proposed budget. 66% of the proposed budget will go to the Office of the Health Secretary. Because of this, several specialty hospitals are facing budget cuts. These include the National Kidney Transplant Institute, Lung Center of the Philippines, the Philippine Heart Center, and the Philippine Children's Medical Center.
Nagbawas. In short, bawas din ang subvention natin. Hindi naman, these are, NEP levels are the same and the operating expenses are covered. Luckily, we have MIP.
The budget for medical assistance to indigent patients will also go down from 32.6 billion to 22.3 billion pesos. This despite the fact that affordable health care for all is one of the priority agendas of President Marcos Jr. Meanwhile, lawmaker Janet Garin wants stricken off the record comments made by Kabataan Party List Representative Raul Manuel, who blamed the Marcos administration for the budget cuts.
Hindi dapat ganito sa DOH. Dapat po ma-restore yung cut at kaya taasan pa po.
Hindi pa po pwede na meron tayong drama na pinapalabas natin na lahat ng programa ng kalusugan ay tinapyasan and making the administration look back where in fact it is not true.
In the meantime, Health Secretary Ted Herbosa admits they are having a hard time filling 4,000 vacant nursing positions in government hospitals. He adds the country needs more than 100,000 nurses.
The plantilla items are open for registered and licensed nurses to apply to. However, on our computations, we actually see that we actually have a nursing gap of about 127,000 nurses.
But he gave the assurance the agency can pay COVID frontliners. PhilHealth, for its part, vowed to settle its debt to various hospitals.
I'm happy to state to Honorable Congressman that we will completely, hopefully, or very high percentage po within 90 days, no? Yung 27 billion po. Pwede nyong naka-record naman to, di ba? So, within 90 days po, we will try to pay a very high percentage of the 27 billion.
Health workers slamming the health department's budget cut. The Alliance of Health Workers say the downsized budget reflects the Marcos administration's insincerity. It adds government is abandoning its responsibility to provide free and quality health services to the public. The Filipino Nurses United, meanwhile, fears the budget slash will make essential health services become more out of reach for majority of Filipinos. The group also calls on government to prioritize the welfare of health workers. As for the Alliance for Democracy, it warns the marginalized sector will bear the brunt of the markdown in the budget. It urges government to rechannel confidential and intelligence funds to the health sector.